Incredible. Thank you for that. I travel all around the world telling my story. And so I hear the same sermon over and over again. So that's one of the drawbacks of what I do. The upside of what I do is I get to hear some magnificent music. And so that's where I really worship. That's really the difference for me. So thank you so much for that, because I really need that. I don't know about you, but I needed that this morning. And God's good. Now my heart is singing, and I'm prepared to share with you some things out of God's Word. Before we dig into the Word of God this morning, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the privilege it is to be able to stand up here and the trust that's been placed in me to share your word. And I pray, Lord, this morning that now you would go ahead of us and me in particular, that you would use the words out of your servant's mouth this morning to reach each one of us in a unique way, that the Holy Spirit, Lord, might speak to us. And Lord, my prayer this morning is this, that we would walk out of this place more transformed into the image of Christ than when we first came. Lord, that's your desire for us, but if we walk out of here the same today, Lord, we've missed something, and we've missed you. So, Father, we're here in your house this morning, and I pray that we'd walk out more conformed to the image of Christ than when we first came. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm Dr. Steve Scheibner, and it's a pleasure to be with you this morning. I'm going to tell you a little bit of my background, and then I'm going to tell you my God story, or as old Paul Harvey used to say, the rest of the story. And the pastor gave a little bit of my introduction, but there's a little bit more to my story. I've been married to the fair and lovely Mrs. Scheibner for 29 years. This year will be our 30th anniversary. We're very excited about that. It's hard to imagine how fast 30 years went by, but it's gone by in really a heartbeat. We have 8 children. Pastor introduced 7. I did a count. I went back into the computer and I checked. We actually have 8. But honestly, after 5, it's all the same. So, you know, if you're going to have 5, you might as well have 15, you know, because everything is just supersized. You buy supersized meals, you have a supersized van, you know, and everything is a major troop movement. 3 of my children, the oldest 3, are married now. I have 2 that they call tweeners. They're not married, but they're out on their own, sort of paying their own bills. And then I've got 3 still at home that are, you know, eager to get on with their lives, and so are we. So we're having 3. After 8, having 3 is like having a vacation. It really is. It's no thing at all. And but we love our children, and they're all doing well with the Lord, and that's one of the things we're very excited about. I'm a pilot for American Airlines, and I'm going to tell you my pilot story today. I'm still a pilot for American Airlines. In fact, I was just in Milan, Italy yesterday, working for American. I flew back here yesterday, landed in JFK, took a nice flight on Delta down here last night, and then this afternoon I'll head back to London to tell my 9/11 story over there at an evangelistic outreach that they're trying to do in downtown London. And then Tuesday morning, I'll be back on an airplane back to the United States. I wish I got frequent flyer miles for all this. I don't. I'm an airline pilot, so I bum a ride going places back and forth, and I don't even rack up any miles for it. But I am busy, and that's good, because that's the way the Lord wired me. Now, by way of education, I've got 2 master's degrees. I've got 1 in theology. I've got another one in Christian counseling. And then I have my doctor of ministry degree. A dissertation was on the role of parents in the character development of children. So that's a passion of mine and my wife. We travel around the country many times telling my 9/11 story and teaching parenting conferences as well. We really believe that the American family is in crisis these days. And, you know, all you need to do is go to a restaurant to see that that's really true. And the American family needs help. And so I'm going to ask you to help me reach American families. Now, hopefully on the way in, you were handed a little card, a little 3x5 card here, or maybe it's a little bit bigger than that. But it says at the top, help us reach American families. Now, our ministry these days is called Character Health. And Character Health is designed to equip parents to train a new generation of courageous, Christ-like, what we call character-healthy leaders. And here's what I'm asking for. I don't want your money. All right? I'm not asking for your money. I'm asking for your email address. Now, many times we're reluctant to give up our email address because we think we're going to get on a list or somebody's going to sell our email. I'm not going to do any of that. In fact, the only list you're going to get on is ours. And we're going to send you my blog, my wife's blog, and also a thing called the Character Quality of the Day, which comes out weekly. You're going to absolutely love the content. How does that help us reach American families? You help expand our reach and our clout out there in the outside world by providing your email address. When you go to a publisher and you say, hey, I've got this nice book, like this one right here, and I'd like to get it published, the first thing they ask you is not anything about the book. The first thing they ask you is, how many people are interested in what you do? And when you say 400, they say, go away, lad, and come back later, right? When you say 40,000, that publisher says, pull up a seat and let's talk about your book. All right, and that's the power of collectiveness. That's what it does for us. And so we started out our list last year at about 400 people. Right now we have around 15,000 on that list. And I would love it if you helped us expand that list and reach out to people. You're going to love what you get from us at the end of the day. So fill that out. And at the end of the service, just come back by the table back there. I've got a little bucket back there on my table. Just throw it in there. And in a day or two, we'll enter your emails into our database. And then you'll get a confirmation email. Actually, you'll get two. One from me, one from my wife. Simply respond to that, and that starts the ball rolling. All right, so that's the second phase. Now, the other thing is the DVD. And you're not going to get to see the film this morning. I talked to Pastor about it, and he said, the church is so bright, we just don't have the ability to show films in here. And normally when I give this talk, we start out with this 15-minute film. It's called In My Seat. Some of you may have seen it on YouTube. This film has been viewed by over 2.1 million times on YouTube. 2.1 million views on YouTube, we're told, translates into 8 to 10 million people. That's an absolute God thing. Now, this is my story that I'm going to tell you this morning in documentary style. You're absolutely going to love this film. It's only 15 minutes long. Better get out your little tissue. It gets a little sad towards the middle, but it has a terrific ending. And that's the really neat part about this, because it shares the gospel very, very clearly. And so the other thing I bring with me when I speak is stacks and stacks of this thing on DVD. I've got those on the back table back there. You may be thinking of a friend, a neighbor, a coworker, a relative that you want to reach with the gospel, that person that you've been praying for a while, but you're not sure, you know, whether they're ever going to come to church or whether they're ever going to get it. This is one of the bridges that we can build to that person. So I'm going to encourage you to go grab a couple of three of these on your way out, pray about it, hand them out this week, and then follow up in a few days and say, hey, what'd you think about that pilot guy's story? You're already going to know the story because you're going to hear it this morning. But then follow up and say, hey, what'd you think about it? It's going to open the door to a conversation that you've been praying would open up for a long time, all right? So that's the In My Seat film on DVD. And the final thing is the book, and I'm going to read an excerpt out of the book, but my wife wrote this book. She's a lovely lady. She's an excellent, excellent writer, and she has written a number of books. This is the story that we couldn't put into a 15-minute film. This is all the rest of the stuff, but it's an inspirational and encouraging story about what God can do through one person, through one family, one life that's really committed to him. The Scheibners are not extraordinary people. We are exceedingly average people. I describe myself as a C-minus student in life, and this week was definitely a C-minus, D-plus week for me. And you know what? But I serve an extraordinary God who can do some incredible things through not much to work with. Do you understand what I'm talking about? All right. I'm going to read to you an excerpt out of the book, and it's right out of the very beginning, the preface, and it sets the tone for what I'm going to share with you next. But it starts out like this. The book is called In My Seat. It says, the sun beat warmly on Tom McGinnis' shoulders as he finished his pre-flight inspection for American Airlines Flight 11. His early morning duties were made more bearable by the beautiful, sunny New England morning. With the outside of the airplane inspected and prepared, Tom returned to the cockpit to complete the pre-flight brief with Captain John Oganowski. The exterior walk-around and brief were as natural to Tom as breathing. He had practiced them so many times that they were second nature, just a part of who he was as a first officer for American Airlines. While the cockpit crew was rehearsing their well-practiced takeoff brief, another inhabitant of Flight 11 was busy rehearsing his own takeoff scenario. Muhammad Atta slid into business class seat 8D. The connection from his flight from Portland, Maine had been tighter than he would have liked, and now he was hurriedly settled into his seat to mentally prepare for the events that would soon follow. He had rehearsed his plan so many times, it was as much a part of who he was as the pre-flight was a part of Tom. He scanned the airplane, making sure that his fellow conspirators were in their places. They were. Between first class and business class, the soon-to-be hijackers filled five seats. All was going according to plan. Flight attendants Karen Martin and Barbara Agostera completed their cabin preparations. They checked to make sure that everyone's seatbelt was fastened and their tray tables were locked. They examined the seatbelt of Muhammad Atta. His safety was their main concern. Muhammad Atta was examining the flight attendants as well, but he wasn't concerned for their safety. Rather, he was concerned that they might stand in his way. To him, they weren't humans, they were infidels. And as such, an obstruction to his well-thought-out plan, they would have to die. Two states away, in Brunswick, Maine, Steve Scheibner stepped through the doors of Wing 5, the headquarters of the Commodore of Naval Air Station, Brunswick, Maine. His unexpected day off from flying for American Airlines had provided an opportunity to meet with the Commodore to discuss a project that he was working on. "Good morning, sir," barked the command duty officer as Commander Scheibner stepped through the door. After 18 years in the Navy, the daily greeting and requisite salute were nothing new. He had practiced them so many times that they were ingrained in his being, just a part of who he was as a naval officer. Before stepping into the Commodore's office, Steve prayed a silent prayer for the man behind the door. For you see, that was just a part of who Steve was as well. As a Christian and a pastor in a local church, the Commodore wasn't just his boss. He was a man that Steve cared for deeply and upheld in prayer. It didn't take much thought. Praying was stamped into his heart and built into his life. It, too, characterized who he was in every part of his life. Pastor, commander, first officer, husband, and father. Three men, all well practiced at their chosen professions, all ready to do whatever was necessary to complete their day's mission, all intersected at one horrific moment in time that would change their lives forever. 7:40 a.m., Tom McGinnis dialed clearance delivery on frequency 121.65 to gain a pushback clearance. 7:43 a.m., both engines of the Boeing 767 roared to life and Tom called ground control to taxi the airplane. 8 a.m., American Airlines flight was cleared for takeoff from Boston Tower. Tom pushed the power levers forward, and as the engines howled, passengers and crew alike were pressed back into their seats as the airplane accelerated. At 143 knots, Captain John Oganowski called rotate. Tom pulled back on the yoke, and the flight to Los Angeles began. The flight leveled at 26,000 feet, and Tom engaged the autopilot. 8:13 a.m., air traffic control instructed the crew to turn 20 degrees right. John replied, American 11, turning 20 degrees right. That would be the cockpit crew's last transmission. Removing his seatbelt, Muhammad Atta rose from his seat. Tom's mission was over. Atta's would now begin. For the next 32 minutes, Atta and his co-conspirators carried out their reign of terror. In that time, they would slash the throats of both Tom, John, stab two flight attendants, and a passenger in first class. They herded the passengers to the rear compartment of the airplane and contained them with mace and pepper spray. They admonished the passengers to cooperate and they would live. That was a lie. 8:46 a.m., gripping the yoke with blood-stained hands and fueled with a fanatical frenzy, Muhammad Atta slammed the huge 767 into the north tower of the World Trade Center. No one aboard Flight 11 would survive. Three men, three missions. The horrific events of September 11th would end the missions of two, but one lived on. And that's where this story really begins. September 11th, 2001 is what I call a major life event. It's one of those moments where your brain takes a snapshot of exactly where you were. And as I'm describing that to you right now, can't you picture in your mind's eye exactly where you were? Even though it's been a dozen years, can you believe it's been 12 years since 9/11? But you can picture in your mind's eye right now, can't you, where you were, that first television screen that you were looking at? Many times the emotions even come rushing back to you. At first you looked at that screen and you didn't believe it. You thought, this isn't really happening in real time, but it took a minute or so and it sunk in and you thought, this is really taking place on our soil. And then the resolve of the day set in and it lasted for a while. You see, I believe that the Lord puts that little snapshot mechanism inside of us for a reason. From time to time in our lives, we need to stop and focus on that which is most important and exclude that which is least important. And that's exactly why God puts that in us. And that's what we're going to do this morning. In the few minutes that we've got remaining, we're just going to stop and focus on that in life which is most important and exclude that which is least important. And by the way, all the least important stuff, it'll be waiting for you at your car when you get out there, all right? It's not going to go away, but it's still here. But for a few minutes, we're going to just stop and share the rest of the story. Now, over the last 12 years now, I get asked two questions primarily. And the two questions I've been asked are, how do you like flying airplanes? And how has your life changed since the events of 9/11? And the one question is a whole lot easier to answer than the other. I love flying airplanes, and most commercial airline pilots will tell you they love what they do for a living. In fact, I can't believe I get paid to stare out the window, you know, but I do. But I got to tell you, it gets a little boring up in the cockpit sometimes. In fact, I'd put it this way. Flying a commercial airliner is 99% boredom, punctuated by 1% sheer terror, okay? And 1% sheer terror took place on 9/11, but the other 99% of what I do, quite honestly, is trying to fight fatigue and stay awake, and it's a little boring up there. I'm just being honest with you. Now, don't go running for the exits just yet. You know, I do stay awake in the cockpit, but it's a bit of a challenge. And you can picture, you know, I'm staring at the instruments, they're staring back at me, not a whole lot's happening, the sun's beating in on me through the window, and sometimes you feel like an old lizard on a rock in the summer down in Atlanta, you know what I'm talking about? And now, some funny things happen in those moments where you get a little bored, and to illustrate my point about the boredom, this is about 7-8 years ago, I guess. I was coming back from Los Angeles to Boston. That was my normal route back in the day, and I was at 37,000 feet. I think I was somewhere over Kansas, because it was just as flat as could be down below, and I'm staring out the window of the airplane. And as I was staring out the window, I started counting all the crop circles down below, all right? Now, that's a bad idea when you're tired. It's kind of like counting sheep, you know? The next thing is your head's going to hit the dash. But as I'm counting all these crop circles and staring out the window, all of a sudden a thought occurred to me that I hadn't thought about in decades, and it was funny. And it caught me off guard, and I started laughing. And I started laughing so hard, I started to lose it. You ever had that happen to you? All right? You're in a crowd of people, and you're losing it. You're laughing so hard, and everybody's got their arms folded, you know, when are you going to get your act together? And now in the cockpit, it's just the captain and I, it's just the two of us, and I'm just totally losing it. And every 30 seconds or so, I'd start to kind of calm down a little bit, and he'd say, Steve, what is so funny? And I'd try to get it out, and another wave of laughter would crash over me, right? So this goes on for an eternity. When you're having a belly laugh, like 3 minutes is a really long time. So at the end of 3 or 4 minutes, I finally calmed down one more time, and he said, Steve, what in the world is so funny? And I said, all right, are you ready? I said, Mrs. McWilliams. And he looked at me like you're looking at me right now, like, what in the world? I said, all right, let me explain Mrs. McWilliams. Mrs. McWilliams was my fourth grade teacher, and Mrs. McWilliams was not a nice lady. In fact, this gal was mean and rotten to the core, all right? Now, I know that some of you are school teachers here. I myself am a teacher, and I think that what you do for a living is absolutely fantastic. But perhaps like one out of every 100,000 teachers ought to look for something else to do for a living, okay? That was our Mrs. McWilliams. She had these three rulers that she had taped together, and she used that thing like an assault weapon in the classroom. If your fingers were over the edge of the desk, that was one of her pet peeves. She'd sneak up behind you. You never heard this lady coming. I mean, her shoes didn't squeak nothing. She was totally stealth. She'd take that club of hers and she'd whack your knuckles for all she would worth, and oh man, that would hurt when she would do that. Now, I want you to come into the classroom with me, all right? You're an 8-year-old boy. It's just outside Detroit, Michigan. It's early November, and the first snow of the season is just starting to gently fall outside, all right? Where do you want to be right now? Huh? Right, trapped with Mrs. McWilliams? Or outside with that first snow? Now, the first I realized that this lady was somewhere in my vicinity was when the pain radiated from the side of my leg up to my brain. And she had taken that switch of hers and she had whacked me in the side of the leg for all she was worth. And then she leaned over and she hissed this in my ear, and I'll never forget what she said. She said, Stevie Scheibner, you'll never make a living staring out the window. So vindication came 40 years later for an 8-year-old boy at 37,000 feet somewhere over Kansas. Absolute true story. And now there's a little bit more to flying a commercial airliner than just staring out the window, but it does occupy a great deal of my time. And by the way, there are more Mrs. McWilliams stories as well. And if you want to come and see me at the table afterwards, I'll sign a book for you. And I don't mind throwing that lady under the bus at all, so I'll tell you some more good stories, all right? So how about that other question? You know, how has your life changed since the events of 9/11? And that's a little harder question to answer. You don't just wake up one morning and have an answer to that. It's a process. It's been a number of years. In fact, I'm still involved in that process, I think, today, going around and telling my story. But the Lord kept bringing me back to a passage in Scripture over and over again. And when the Lord repeats something, you got to pay attention, right? So he kept bringing me back to John chapter 21. If you've got your Bibles with you this morning, John 21 is going to be our text. And because as I began to think about what a major life event 9/11 was, I thought to myself, well, it's not the only major life event we've had in the history of this country. My very first childhood memory was when John F. Kennedy was assassinated. I remember I was about 3 years old at the time, and I remember my parents standing in front of our TV, and tears were coming down their face. And they were standing in front of our old, remember the technology of the day, our old 19-inch black and white Philco TV. Remember those? And when you were younger, you were the remote control and the antenna adjuster. Remember, you used to have to put one foot up and hold the antenna? And so I remember that, and I remember them crying, and I put it together later that that's when the president had been shot. I remember where I was when Reagan was shot and when the Space Shuttle Challenger blew up, and there's many major life events that your brain takes that little snapshot. There are many of you in this room that are old enough to remember December 7th, 1941, when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor. And that's, even though it's been over 70 years, you can still remember it as though it were yesterday. That's how powerful those little snapshots are in our lives. But then it occurred to me, thought, you know, as powerful as 9/11 has been, and it really has been the defining event of our age, and as significant as December 7th, 1941 was in its day, both of those events pale in comparison to the greatest major life event of all time. And I'm speaking now of the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Am I right about that? You and I are gathered together in a room 2,000 plus years later. Why? Because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. That's one of the things that we have in common. You talk about a major life event that has compelling story to it and something that will change and transform lives. That's it. So I thought, what if we ask the disciples the question, how has your life changed? Right after the greatest major life event of all time, perhaps there'd be some insight for me, and perhaps there's some insight for us today. And that takes us to John 21. The significance of John 21 is this. It's the last chapter written in the last gospel of the earthly ministry of Jesus Christ. And it's after the resurrection. That's key. I'm going to read the first four verses, and it sets the stage for what's coming next. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. So that's seven of the now remaining 11 disciples. Now, don't think my math is off. Remember, Judas has hung himself at this point, so there's only 11 apostles at this point, or disciples. And seven of them are together in John 21. Verse 3. Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. And they said to him, well, we'll go with you. And they went out, and they got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. The stage is now set for Jesus to teach one final lesson to seven of the remaining 11 disciples. What's the lesson he's trying to teach them? I believe he was trying to teach me, and I think he's trying to teach us. That is this, and I went up and I'm down, I'm back again. It's like a pilot, you go up, you go down. It's good. Would you like me to stand behind this thing? I just need an acknowledgement, yes? No? Okay, I can keep moving. What's the lesson that he's trying to teach all of us? Well, I think the lesson is this. He needs to get them and me and us to stop living like someday saints and start living like borrowed time believers. What's the difference between a someday saint and a borrowed time believer? Well, a someday saint is that museum piece of a Christian who's always going to get around to it someday. Whatever it is that God wants them to do with their lives, they're going to do it. They're just not going to do it today. They're the king and queen of the procrastinators. They kick the can down the road. They keep God at arm's length. Why do they do it? Well, they've got a plan for their day and their week and their month, and God's plan doesn't necessarily fit into their plan. Remember, you had a plan for Tuesday, September 11th, 2001? What happened to that plan that day? It got interrupted, didn't it? It seemed like the whole world came to a stop that day. So many times in life, we have a plan, but if God's plan doesn't fit into Steve's plan, then we get into a fight. We get into this wrestling match, and that's not healthy. I live like that someday saint far too often. I'm ashamed to tell you how many times over the last 35 years I've been walking with the Lord that I've kept God at arm's length. It's shameful, really. But a borrowed time believer is different. They live every day with a sense of urgency and purpose and passion. They know that every day on this earth is a precious gift from God. And if you're here in this room this morning and you've ever been diagnosed with cancer, you've had a life-threatening illness or injury, you understand exactly what I'm talking about right now, because you know that you're living on borrowed time. In fact, you can mark it on the calendar, and you're trying to get the most out of every day, and hopefully not the most just for you, but the most for the bigger picture, the kingdom of God, the cause of Christ. So how is he going to get them and me and us to move out of that someday saint mentality and into that borrowed time believer sense of urgency? Well, he's going to ask us three questions, and here's the first. Are you ready? What are you doing here? Isn't that a great question? What are you doing here? Now, in the first four verses, Jesus simply shows up. He doesn't utter a word. Don't think I'm being loose with the text here. How can you ask a question without uttering any words? Well, you can simply imply a question by showing up. Before my mom passed away, she shared with me a story about when she was a little girl. And this is way back in the day, but for 10 cents, for a dime, on Saturday afternoons, you could go to the local movie theater and watch three features. And she said, as she explained it to me, she said, I had a dime burning a hole in my pocket. And she said, the only thing standing between me and success was my dad, your grandfather. And she said, so I went to my dad that morning. I said, Daddy, I said, I've got 10 cents, so does my girlfriend. We'd like to go to the movie theater this afternoon. May we please go to the movies? He said, sweetheart, you may not go to the movies. Now, you had to know my mom. She was a really determined lady, and I'm sure she was a pretty determined little girl. You know what's going to happen next, right? Early that afternoon, she disappears, and she said it was about halfway through the first feature. I was really enjoying the movie when I noticed a pair of man's shoes just standing there in the aisle, and she said, I didn't even need to look up. She said, I recognized them to be my dad's one and only pair of shoes. She said, so I slipped up my hand. My dad grabbed my hand. He walked me all the way home. A full 20 minutes we walked home. He didn't utter a word. She said, I wanted him to yell at me or scold me or something. He didn't say a word. Why? Why didn't he say anything? You see, he didn't need to. See, simply by showing up, he communicated a much louder message to her. And that message was this. Sweetheart, you don't belong here. You see, that's the message that Jesus is communicating to these disciples at this moment. Now, I'm sure he didn't call these guys sweetheart, you know, but the equivalent. Gentlemen, you don't belong here. I've uniquely qualified you to transform the world for the cause of Jesus Christ. Seven of the men that he called, and by the way, when he first called them, he called them to become fishers of what? Fishers of men. Now seven of them are back in the boat fishing for fish. Not a good use of their time. Simply by showing up, he asks the question, what are you doing here? And he's not talking about in the boat. He's talking about here on this earth. What are you doing here on this earth? Are you going to leave this place a better place for the cause of Christ than when you first arrived? Or is this all about the accumulation of stuff, which, by the way, you can't take with you? We just buried my uncle about 10 months ago. He didn't take anything with him. Now everybody else is fighting over his stuff like it's important. What are you going to take with you? What are you doing here on this earth? It's a great question to wrestle with today, isn't it? Now the second question comes on the heels of the first. And in verse 5, Jesus now speaks for the first time. And Jesus said to them, children, do you have any fish? Do you ever wonder why God ever asks a question? Right? Let that sink in for a minute. Now, he's the God of the universe. He already knows the answer to that question before he asks it. He already knows there's no fish out in that boat. And whenever he asks a question, it's always for our benefit, right? And you also know what it's like when you're cold and you're tired and you're cranky and you're hungry and maybe you're a little bit embarrassed and you want to cut off the conversation. Don't you give one of those snippy one-word answers, right? The missus and I do it with each other all the time. And so one of the guys in the boat yells this back, no. I don't know about you. Aren't you glad that God doesn't accept no for an answer? Think about where your walk with Christ would be if he accepted no from you the first time. So I picture Jesus just puts a smile on his face now, and he's going to begin to walk these men back down memory lane. He says, take that net you got in the boat and throw it out on the other side. 3 years prior to this, when he first called Peter to be his follower back in Luke chapter 5, Peter had been out fishing all night, hadn't caught a single fish. Jesus shows up, says, throw the net on the other side. It fills up with fish so quickly, he can hardly haul it back in. John 21, they're going to do the same thing. There's only one guy, by the way, that fishes like that, and that's Jesus. And so when the net begins to fill up with fish in John 21, Peter gets so excited, he jumps out of the boat and he swims to shore. That's excited. All right? He goes up and he greets the Lord soaking wet. The other guys are rowing the boat back, you know, pulling the heavy net with the fish behind it. Thanks a lot, Peter. Right? They finally get back to the beach and they stop there. And Peter's a good guy, though. While they go greet the Lord, he grabs those nets and he's pulling them up on the shore. And boy, they're getting heavier and heavier, but Peter's a sturdy guy. He pulls them up and you can see the fish flopping around and you can hear the fish in the nets. You can even smell the fish in your nostrils. Peter now is reunited with the resurrected God of the universe. I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to that moment where I'm in Jesus' presence and I can see the holes in his hands. I can see the hole in his side. I can see the scars on his face from the thorn of crowns. I want to see that. I'm looking forward to that moment. Peter's right in that moment. And right now, Peter stops to take time to count the fish. Does that strike you as odd? 153 large fish, we're told in verse 11. Peter loves the Lord. Don't get me wrong. Steve loves the Lord. But Peter loves those fish too. Steve loves the things that, like those fish in life, in a day or two or three are going to begin to rot and smell and decay, and then I got to go out and do it all over again. You know what I'm talking about? You know, the routines of life where you just got to do it over and over again. And sometimes we fall in love with those things. Those things in life which are temporary, many times we love more than that which is what? Eternal. And we get our priorities all backwards. And Jesus has to show up in the middle of that and say, what are you doing here? And then the second question is this. What are you fishing for in life, really? What are you fishing for in this life? Well, we know now it's nothing you can take with you. Unless it's the souls of men, that's something that lasts for eternity. But if it's stuff here on this earth, it doesn't go with you. What are you fishing for in life, really? And if you're having a hard time answering that, check your calendar and your checkbook. That which you spend your time and your money on is that which is what you're really fishing for in life. They know the answer to the question already. What are you doing here? What are you fishing for in life, really? Now, turn the page with me because I love verse 12. And verse 12 is what I call man breakfast. Now, let me read it to you out loud. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. And it says, none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? Because they knew it was the Lord. Now, ladies, you don't understand man breakfast. Because if you came along, it's now no longer man breakfast. But when men go out to have breakfast, this might be shocking to you. All right, are you ready for this? There's no talking required. We can have a great time. Like, I know a bunch of you guys, I just met you this morning. I bet you we could go out to man breakfast and have a great time together and not utter a single word. You know, we could grunt at each other like a bunch of cavemen for the better part of a half an hour. Past the salt's probably as deep as the conversation gets. And it's the ultimate in male bonding. It really is. All right? Now, ladies, you don't understand it. I've got a boy. He's 20 years old now, and he loves to go out to man breakfast. So once a month or so, he and I go out to the local Greasy Spoon, and we get all the stuff that's bad for you. And we grunt at each other like a couple of cavemen for half an hour. We drive home, and we're coming up the driveway, and my wife has got her face pressed up against the window. You know, she's just so excited because her boys have been out for an hour bonding, you know. She can't wait to see us when we come through the door. And so we come through the door, and she springs the question. She turns to him, and she says, did you have a good time with your dad? And he says, oh, yeah, I had a great time. And help me with this, ladies. The next question she says is this. So what did you talk about? He looks like a trapped animal, all right? He's like, I don't know. We didn't talk about anything. Dad, help me. So now she's concerned. So she turns to me. She goes, did you have a good time? Yeah, sweetie, I had a great time. Round two, what did you talk about, right? I'm like, honey, I don't know. It's man breakfast. We grunt. It's okay. It really is. Every once in a while, there's trash talk. And trash talk is when you lower the other guy to elevate yourself. It's very juvenile, but extremely masculine. You know what I'm saying? Guys, the guys understand what I'm talking about. But this is much more than a bunch of cavemen having breakfast together, all right? In fact, the tension is so thick right now in verse 12 that you can cut it with a knife. And to their credit, nobody's going to be the first fool to open his mouth. And Jesus is simply serving breakfast. Did you ever wonder when did Peter and the others get it? When did it finally click for Peter? There's so many episodes where Peter just doesn't get it. We identify with Peter, don't we? I do. There are so many times I just don't get it. I think Peter and the others got it in verse 13. Let me read verse 13. It's what I call a flyover verse. If you don't stop and linger here, you're going to miss the rich significance in verse 13. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. You go, well, Steve, what's the big deal about verse 13? I mean, we already know it's on the menu. We've been told a couple times, bread and fish, what's the big deal? It's because of the action that goes with it. Put yourself in the shoes of these seven men. For you, when was the last time Jesus took a piece of bread and broke it and handed it to you? By the way, it was about a week ago for you. Where were you? It was a place called the Upper Room, and it was the Last Supper, just prior to the crucifixion. Suppose that was a major life event for you? Suppose that was a little moment where your brain took a snapshot? I'm thinking it was for these guys. And last time Jesus took a piece of bread and broke it and handed it to you, what did he say? He said, this is my body, broken for you. Do this as often as you gather together in remembrance of me. Nothing in there about going fishing for fish. Everything in there about going fishing for men. Everything in there about transforming the world for the cause of Jesus Christ and moving from that someday saint mentality to that borrowed time believer sense of urgency. After the resurrection, they had everything they needed. And without a word, Jesus delivers the most brilliant message yet in this chapter. He simply takes a piece of bread and breaks it and looks them in the eye one after another. And you know what? Had that been me, I would have cried like a little baby. I cry easily. I would have cried. These men got it in verse 13. But to drive the point home now in verse 15, 16, and 17, Jesus turns his attention to Peter, and he asks him that now famous question, do you love me more than these? Three times Jesus asks him that question, do you love me more than these? Now the these that Jesus is speaking about could be any number of things. It could be the other men that are there. That's true. It could be. Could be the distractions of life. There's lots of those, right? It could be the 153 large fish flopping around in the nets during our silent man breakfast. You know, the point is this. If there's something you love more than Jesus, that's a problem, right? That's the question he's asking us, and I'm asking you today. What do you love more than Jesus? I guarantee this week, through your choices, your actions, your words, your deeds, your behavior, there was something that you loved more than Jesus. Am I right about that? Just slip up your hand if there was something this week that you loved more than Jesus. Just let me see your hand. Okay? For many of us, if we're unwilling to do that, it's pride that we love more than Jesus. You know, there's something that we love, maybe it's ourselves, more than Jesus. That's a typical week. Just follow me around. You're going to see lots of things that I choose over the Lord. It's shameful, really. But it's part of that someday saint mentality. So what are you doing here? What are you fishing for in this life, really? And what do you love more than Jesus? You see, the Lord brought all three of those questions into my life on September 11th, 2001. What was I doing back in those days? Well, in those days, I was an active naval reserve officer. You heard that from the book. I was pastoring a church that I had planted up in Brunswick, Maine, and the church was growing. My family was growing. Things were going well. I was a busy guy. But the rest of the story goes like this. In order for me to do all of the things that I do, I have to bid something that's called reserve at American Airlines. Now, what does reserve mean? Well, reserve is kind of like a part-time status. I'm there to fill in for a pilot that for whatever reason can't make a trip. Maybe he's sick, he has to go to training. There's some sort of conflict and there's an open seat in the cockpit. There is a whole list of us on reserve, and it goes by seniority. And so typically the computer will look down the list, and whoever is the most junior is the one that gets to go. On September 11th, 2001, I was bidding reserve. I was the only pilot on call in Boston on September 11th. So with that being said, the computer automatically will take my name and assign it to that trip. So at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon on September 11th, 2001, I went over to the computer like I normally do. That's the time that the computer will assign your name, and then in a few minutes later, somebody will call and tell you, Steve, you've got a trip, you're going to work tomorrow. I looked on the computer, and there was my name, Scheibner, written in as the co-pilot on American Airlines Flight 11. I turned to my wife and I said, honey, I'm going to Los Angeles tomorrow. I went out to the car, I got my old suitcase out of the trunk, I threw the dirty stuff in the wash, I cleaned, put the clean stuff in and took the trunks back out to the car and put it, closed the lid and walked back into the house. I said, did they call yet? And she said, no. Usually within 2 or 3 minutes, the phone rings. Half an hour went by, an hour went by, 2 hours went by, I forgot about it altogether. Whole evening went by, and later on that evening, I said, hey, they never called to assign that trip. Well, something must have happened, I don't know. At the same time, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, a fellow by the name of Tom McGinnis was celebrating his 42nd birthday with his wife and his children. Tom did what I did that afternoon. He went to the computer and he logged in and he saw that my name had been assigned to the flight, but there was a little code next to it that said it hadn't been confirmed yet. Tom still had a few minutes. Tom called down to American Airlines and said, I don't know, but is it too late? Am I legal for that trip? Can I still have it? They said, well, yeah, you're legal. You can fit it in. And the parameters that he has to fit are these. He can't go over 30 hours total flying in 7 days. He has to have enough FAA rest after his last flight and enough before his next flight. He has to be able to want to go flying, and that flight has to be available. And so with all of those small parameters met, Tom qualified. Tom called. Tom talked to his wife, and Tom called back. And he said, I'll take that trip. At that moment, they erased my name from the flight. They put Tom's in. I didn't know any different because they never called. Tom showed up for work on September 11th, 2001. As you recall, it was a beautiful day in New England. They pushed back off the gate in time. They took off on time. They flew up to 26,000 feet. And all heck broke loose on that airplane that day. And the rest is history. I'm here this morning to tell you I know what it's like to have somebody die in my place. Not once, but twice. And once was enough. You see, Tom, the pilot who bumped me that day, he'd be the first guy to tell you that he did not die for my sins. How can I say that with confidence? Here's a silver lining on this little dark story. Are you ready? Tom had a solid testimony of faith in Jesus Christ. When Tom was a young man, when he was about 17 years old like me, he gave his heart to the Lord. And on September 11th, 2001, Tom went straight from that bloody cockpit straight into the arms of the Lord. But the other who died in my place, the other who died in Tom's place, the other who died in your place was far more significant. The Lord Jesus Christ hung and bled and suffered on a cross to pay a price that he and he alone was uniquely qualified to pay. See, Tom and I could have swapped out for each other on any given day. We were both qualified to sit in that seat, but only one has ever been qualified to go to the cross of Calvary and pay the price so that you and I could be right with God again. Why did Jesus do it? Why did he go endure such humiliation for you and me? Two reasons, really. Out of faithful obedience to God the Father, that's how much he loves the Father, and out of a deep and abiding love for you and I, the object of his passion. I hope you haven't been walking with the Lord so long you've gotten out of touch with that. But today's a great reminder, isn't it? That the Lord died for you. And he didn't have to. He suffered such a humiliating death on the cross. How can you keep that type of love at arm's length? You see, that type of love requires, even demands, a response on our part. How would you respond to the deep and abiding love of Jesus today? What are you doing here? What are you fishing for in this life, really? And what do you love more than Jesus? And by the way, there's nothing in this universe that he loves more than you. He's already proven that on the cross of Calvary. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, thank you for the privilege it is to be able to share this morning my God story. And Lord, you know I was reluctant for a number of years to go tell my story. I don't like talking about myself, but Lord, you told me it's not about you, Steve. This is about me. And Lord, each one of us here this morning has a God story to tell. And you're writing that God story right now as we sit here. But Father, I wonder, as we've been talking about you, you've really been talking to us in our hearts. And Lord, I wonder if there's anybody here in this room. Lord, what a gorgeous day. It's a beautiful room. It's a great place. But Lord, you've been speaking to us. And maybe, Lord, you're talking to us right now as though we were the only person in this room. You're saying, Steve, just get to it. Ask the question because I know now that Jesus Christ died for me and I've been keeping him at arm's length my entire life. If you're here this morning and you've never taken that very first step of surrender, that very first step of faith with Jesus Christ, and you know that that's what you need to do, don't go out the doors and not do business with God. I'm going to ask you to do this. I'm going to ask you to slip out of where you are. I'm going to ask you to come down forward. Pastor's down here. He's down front. There's others that would love to meet you and pray with you as you come to receive Christ. But Jesus substituted for you so that you could be right with God. How can you keep that at arm's length? If you're ready for the very first time to do business with Jesus, I'm going to ask you to slip out now and come down and see us. While you're making that choice and you're making that walk, I'm going to talk to the rest of us. Maybe you've already made that decision. You know where and when you got saved and how you came to know Jesus Christ, but you've been living a little bit too much like that someday saint, and you've been keeping God at arm's length, and the Lord's talking to you about living with a sense of urgency and passion, regardless of your age. And he's laying a deal on your heart right now, and you say, Lord, I want to respond to you. I'm going to ask you to do this. If you raised your hand just a minute ago when I asked you this week, was there something you loved more than Jesus? I'm going to ask you to come down. And there's beautiful plush carpet down here. Maybe you just need to stand down front. But that movement of coming down forward and kneeling for a minute or two or standing as you're able to and praying and giving that thing over to the Lord will be very important for you, for him, and for this church. I'm going to open it up to that invitation. I'm going to ask you to come down forward and lay that thing at the feet of Jesus. Father, thank you so much for the privilege to be able to share my God story. We pray these things in Jesus' name.